My name is Chris Rice, and I am here with my brother in Christ, Matthew Carter. And we're going to be talking about loneliness and how that is impacting really Americans all across the demographics. And it's so critical that we have this conversation today so that we can speak the truth in love. Stay tuned. Here's help. Matthew, it is a pleasure to be with you again and to be talking about this really important topic. Loneliness is it's defined by most definitions, most dictionaries, as an overwhelming feeling of sadness caused by isolation or feeling abandoned, even. And so loneliness is something that I think all of us have felt at one point or another in our lives. But just in general, why do you think so many adults or even children, why is this a problem in the United States or Western cultures specifically?
Yeah, I think for me, you know, we hear these terms and we know it's a part of the human psyche, the human life. But again, I think sometimes we connect it to psychology or so forth. But for me, I think we've gotten out of connecting that silently with God and Christ and what we need to do. I think it's the absence of something in our lives. Mm-hmm. To me, that's what I think. When there's something that's not filled, if there's a void, then there's something missing. And for me, that missing link, loneliness, is missing something in the human experience that needs to be filled. That's where I start. And then I talk about, well, what fills that? And how are people trying to fill it? I think when you're empty, you try to fill it in different ways. And what I found, we can blame it on COVID or whatever, but I'm convinced that that loneliness has been there a good while in America.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think COVID was the context, the circumstance, the situation that we all experienced on a global scale to draw out and expose how lonely we already are. But I think there's so much that's really important to dig into what you just said, that loneliness is an absence of something on a spiritual level.
Yes.
And I absolutely, you know, one thing that I love about God's word is that it's so frank about the human experience. We can actually go to the Bible, and if we were to look for experiences of loneliness, where we would find it in a variety of different places. You know, even Christ, on a very deep level, experienced loneliness on the cross, a level that we can't even really begin to imagine. Imagine being triunely connected with God the Father and to have him forsake you on the cross. That's loneliness that's so deep, we don't even have words to describe it. But I also think of Joseph and how he was treated really poorly by his brothers, how lonely he must have felt, even in Potiphar's house, and how lonely he must have felt in prison, and how lonely he must have felt in all of these different circumstances that were outside of his control. And yet, Joseph always responded in a way that pointed back to God. And I think that's one thing I really love about his story in particular.
And I think that's what I was getting at, is that if there's the absence of something, what do you reach out to fill it? And the Bible always tells me when we get to those points where we're confused or don't know or where to turn, that is the time to turn to God who has created us. Mm-hmm. It sounds simple to us because of our faith, but it's still real that we forget that we are made by a creator who loves us. Mm-hmm. And too often we're trying to find in other places and other things and addiction and mm-hmm. and friendships that don't follow through. All of these things we go after fails us.
Yeah.
And the one thing we have is to search the one who has created us.
Yeah. Matthew 11, verses 28 through 30, Jesus says these words that that are really profound, and they speak to someone who's experiencing loneliness. Jesus says, "Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." And what Jesus is really saying there is that there's an open invitation to deep, meaningful relationship with him. That your burdens that you carry aren't actually what excludes you from relationship with him. They're what drives us to him. And I think this is one reason why we feel so lonely, is that we're trying, you say it in this way, that we're trying to fill that hole in our heart. Another way of saying it is we're trying to carry the burdens of our own sins, of our own efforts, and then even of the efforts of other people that we think are projecting on us, right? We try to appease people so much. And if we just lay those burdens down at the foot of the cross and we carry a relationship with Jesus as our Lord and Savior, his promise to us is that his yoke is light.
Right? Very light.
And that the burden, he is going to take that from you. He's gentle and lowly in heart. What a wonderful description from our very own Savior's mouth.
You know, I always think about sometimes life is not always easy. I think, you know, we look at TV and it's almost like we can just go down and pick the car up we want, you know, and have the house we want. And it seems like the world entices us to what the top of things are. Mm. And yet we find ourselves wanting because we can't have those things. And I'm saying, what are we going after? And I guess I'm getting back to the point that sometimes in our loneliness, we condemn ourselves for what life doesn't give us. Like over expecting what life will do for us. And because of that, then we condemn ourselves that there's something terribly wrong with me, which leads to shame and so forth. But that is the other part of the gospel. And what I like is there is no condemnation. Too often we're condemned by others and community because we just seem like we're not measuring up. But God does not condemn us. You know, in Peter, it says in the pastoral that even the condemnation of your heart, when you know it, that God is even greater than that. In essence, we got to understand that even as, like Paul says, I am weak, and if you take this from me, and he comes to say, in your weakness, there is strength. And that is what we need to hear in the world. Because to be weak in this world is to be the less of all things.
Yeah, amen. What a good word. But beyond that, I think I want to touch on something that you were saying, is that, you know, with what's so remarkable about this problem in this world is that more than ever in history, more than ever, by far, we are technically the most connected we've ever been in the entire world. Like I can pick up my phone, which I carry around in my pocket, and I can call someone from Australia or India and have a conversation with them. And to some extent, I can pull that phone up and also get an image of them and talk with them face to face to some extent.
Yes.
And that's remarkable. But at the same time, here in the United States, there are so many people who are desperate for relationships that go beyond the facade, the thick skin that we put in front of everyone else. You know, the gospel allows Christians to be incredibly vulnerable to other believers and incredibly vulnerable to the world around. Why? Because we are not condemned by the world. We're not condemned by our sin.
Yes.
Satan might try to accuse us, but Christ has already paid for those. And so in an incredibly practical and beautiful way, God has ordained that one man should die for all, that all may die to self and live for that one man. And I've been going through the book of Philippians, and this statement in Philippians 1:21 just continues to strike me. He says, "For me to live is Christ and to die is gain." And if we really lived as though our purpose were to please the Lord with everything that we say and do, that pulls us out of ourselves enough to say that I'm really not lonely, that I've got a Savior, that I've got people around me who love me. And if I don't, then the church, that's what the church was made for. And, you know, I just want our viewers to understand that there are really people out there who are ready and willing and capable to care for you well. But what the first step for you is to get outside of the woe is me mentality and go seek to serve the Lord. And that's really hard practically, but we can do that.
I think when you were talking about that connectedness, I'll go back to say, we don't have community unless we're in commune with God. Mm-hmm. Agreed. If that is absent from us, nothing else is going to fill that. We can reach out to others without commune to God, and it doesn't work because we depend on relationships through family and friends. And 9 out of 10, they're not coming when life gets tough. Going back to COVID, I think we were stripped of all of that connection. I was talking to my goddaughter who just graduated in first year of college, and she said, you know, I regret that I just went online instead of going to school. And then she said, I realized that the friends I had when I did connect with them online, they didn't connect back. So I just went away from it all. So here's an 18, 19-year-old who's regretting that two-year experience. And yet she continues to go on. Lovely child, but has a void in her. And yet she doesn't talk about that unless you ask her.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I guess what I'm getting to is that I'm convinced that even that we could talk to the world. When I look at Facebook and some of this other stuff, there's a big hole in that stuff. Mm-hmm. People reaching out to say, how can I fill my life? And they quote things all the time, but they're not in the Word. And the reason we have that fullness in as a church, we should be able to talk about fullness, but not just talk about it, but show people how to live at that.
Yeah. So I think one thing that, and we've been talking about different aspects of this, it all
fits
each other, okay? But the first point is that when considering loneliness,
you
must have a deep, intimate relationship with Jesus first and foremost, or it's going to be very hard for you to develop long-term, meaningful, fruitful relationships, because the hole in your heart that you feel in loneliness can't ever really be filled by relationships outside of Christ. But once you have that relationship with Christ, the gospel makes it possible for you to practically serve others, and that develops meaningful relationships. So it's kind of it's one of the fruits of the gospel. I think another thing that prevents people from feeling companionship is something that I've struggled with my whole life. It was one of my chief sins before God really radically saved me, and that was the fear of man, which is defined simply as when my behavior, my words, my thoughts, my actions, my feelings are all controlled by how I perceive others thinking of me.
Yes.
So it's this codependency. It's this feeling that if it, to the extent that others are loving me, my life is going well. But the moment that I don't feel that, or that circumstances seem to isolate me, then I'm going to feel really bad. And this causes loneliness. I think it's one of the root causes of it. And let me just tell you that, you know, our viewers, that you must fear the Lord much more than you fear man. You must fear God and what he says of you much more than you worship or fear what others say of you. And that was a really hard lesson for me to learn. But once I understood that me being controlled by others was essentially saying that God is a liar, that his word is not correct, it's not true, that really changed how I viewed it. You know, God created me in his image, but beyond that, I'm a child of God. I'm adopted, I'm redeemed, I'm saved by the blood of Jesus. And how God views me is forever changed by the work and the person of Jesus Christ. And that's what the gospel is, quite simply.
And saying that, you know, I always think of my struggle to come to grips with my loneliness and my emptiness. So here it is. Where can I find that? I certainly could not find that in quotes or other places. And then this thing you said about the word. And then I began to read, honestly, to read the word, the Bible. And I read about Jesus, and every time he said something that I read about him, it was so contrary to who I was. Hmm. And yet he would always say, follow me, take up your cross, deny yourself. And then it's kind of like in Galatians, all of this stuff I'm seeking, peace, love, gentleness, righteousness, is in following him. Hmm. And I say to people, again, from our beginning in your loneliness, what are you reaching out for? Aren't you reaching out for peace and love and gentleness and all the things? But to do that, we have to change and know that we cannot save ourselves. We cannot find that in ourselves. We cannot find that in just a person or a relationship. And the only place we can find that, when we talk about the word, and that's why I challenge people. Don't just say it ain't so. Give yourself some time. Sit with him with the word. And get with somebody who knows Christ. And just take time. We always have diets of food. We're going to try this for 30 days or 60 days. Read the Bible. Go and just concentrate on what Jesus is saying. And then ask God to guide you. And that changed my life. And that's what I'm asking. Too often we don't get that from sermons. We're so turned off sometimes by our understanding of who Christ is. And he is so different. People of, when Jesus came to earth, they all said they knew God, but had no idea of who God was and what he could do. And that's what I'm challenging.
Right.
A church to do and for our listeners. Pick up the word. Find somebody who you believe and trust. And sit down and say, read with me. Pray with me. I want this peace. I want this love. All right?
Yeah, and a great place to go to in the word.
Yeah.
Understand the fear of the Lord.
Yeah.
His power is Job chapters 38 through 42, actually. So if you read the ending of Job 38, chapters 38, all the way through 42, and you did that once a day for a little while, you are going to grow in your understanding of the power of God and the fear of the Lord in a really meaningful way. And basically, it's Job. It's the longest speech that God ever gives to an individual in the Bible. And he's talking to Job, and he's challenging Job in a variety of different ways. And sometimes, to grow in the fear of the Lord, we need to understand who it is that we're talking about and how great and mighty and powerful this God is, and the fact that God loves us in his might, in his power. Not only that, that God is wise beyond belief. Not only that, that he's ruler, he's in control. Why, those are all three very comfortable things. They're very comforting things to someone who's experiencing a really low moment in their life. And that's what loneliness is. They're feeling abandoned, rejected, isolated, that no one wants them, that no one cares about them, that no one loves them. Well, what's the response for a Christian? What should we do? Two things. One, we must point a person who's experiencing loneliness to the power and the work and the might and the love and the grace of Jesus Christ, the Lord and Savior. Okay, any other help that we offer apart from that, being the first and primary one, is going to be fruitless. The second thing is that we can practically serve a person who's experiencing loneliness in real, tangible ways. Make them a meal. Do the dishes. Do some laundry. Help them, not just with your words, but be present with them. Sitting down and comforting them, holding them, hugging them. These are ways that we can tangibly love people well when they're experiencing isolation and heartache like that. And so those are two things that I think are really important that we practice as the church. Yes. Yeah. And this person doesn't have to be a believer to experience
that. No. And you know, when you said that, you know what I thought about is the disciples and the people of God, the Holy Spirit being poured out on flesh. That's what the wonders and signs are. We don't understand hugging, what you talk, doing dishes are wonders and signs because most of the folks don't do that sort of thing.
Yeah.
So it's those very simple things of going the second mile and the Sermon on the Mount, of loving somebody who is not being loved, forgiving somebody who needs to be forgiven. That's exactly what we need to do. Instead of just saying what should do, James says, act out your faith. It's not just in words. And that's what I'm hearing. That's the book of Acts that you were saying.
Yeah, and absolutely. And beyond that, the church is the greatest context for battling the loneliness that that people are feeling in the United States. The church is the greatest context for loving people well. It should be. And what's sad is that so many churches are fields of isolation, where from leadership down, they're encouraging isolation in that they're not gospel-driven, gospel-focused, practically speaking the truth in love to people who are experiencing really hard things. And this is why young people are leaving churches, because you can go to a church that has 10,000 people for 5 years in a row and never meet anybody in leadership, never be challenged to grow in your faith, never be challenged to read your word more, never be held accountable when you're struggling with temptations or sin. I mean, these are the ways in which the church can practically love people well. And we're failing to do that across our country, which is why we're seeing church doors shut more than ever before. COVID did not cause churches being shut. No. The culture that was in those churches that did not allow for thriving in service is the reason why those churches shut down faster. It's because it's because they failed to love.
Yeah. And a lot of people don't know, a lot of that was going on before COVID.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. You know, those churches were struggling to love people well far before COVID, but COVID just put the nail in the coffin, so to speak.
But that's what happened. You know, when you say these things, I have to have a reference. That's what the church in Jerusalem was struggling in Acts. They wanted to stay there. And the Holy Spirit is saying, you got to get out. You got to do. And you have to move and change. And part of loneliness, I think, especially, and I'm talking about specifically the church now, that it did not live out its faith. Mm-hmm. It has power to do something in society, even before COVID, and didn't do that. That we've come to expect a God like a machine, you just pull the crank and whatever you want falls out of it. Instead of being called to hug and to love and to wash the dishes. And let me say this, the power to deal, and you said it, with the loneliness in this society rests with the Holy Spirit that's given to his people. Amen. And his people are not living out what the power God has gave him.
Amen.
If we realize that the Holy Spirit is the one that brought Jesus out of the grave, mm-hmm. the power to heal, to, as he said, the brokenhearted, the one in prisoner, the blind, and we have that boldness and we're afraid to use that.
Yeah. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. If you are not experiencing this power that you have, then, you know, I want to encourage our viewers, if you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, come to him today. You might be experiencing loneliness even now as we're talking. God created you in his image. You have value and dignity, and you have gifts that God has intended that you use for his glory and the good of others. And so if you are in that place and you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, come to him today. You can reach out to New Life, and we would love to talk to you more about our faith and about how to grow in the Lord in really practical ways. So you can reach out 314-421-3020, and you know, Matthew is one of our pastors. He's on our board. I'm one of the pastors. We'd love to speak to you. If you are a Christian, you're a believer, you've loved the Lord for a long time, but you're struggling with loneliness, I want to encourage you to get involved in reading his word, even when it's tough. Reading his word, even when you don't see the point. And as we gave some suggestions, start at Matthew 11, 28 through 30, or Job chapters 38 through 42. These are great places to learn more about God. Reading Joseph's story in Genesis. I just want to encourage our viewers today, speak out. Let people around you know what's going on, and then seek the Lord first and foremost for comfort and strength in the time of need that you're in right now. It's so important to battle this fight with faith, because we don't fight a fight of flesh and blood, but in spirit and truth. And so may God bless you. Thank you so much for watching this show. Matthew and I really enjoyed it.